So I'm delighted to be here today. Thank you, Marianne, for a gracious introduction. And, you know, I think this is going to be an interesting example of, you know, a long-term research project, you know, based on a randomized control trial that I think got some reasonable play in the press and made it very easy for the researchers to get involved in further research, since policymakers themselves, and particularly Greg, reached out to us rather than the other way around. If only it happened that way all the time. So what we want to do is I want to talk a little bit about the original Moving to Opportunities study, what we found. I think getting some stories on the front page in the New York Times probably helped a little bit in making those connections. And then Greg is going to talk about the partnership we have formed to try to extend this research on housing mobility and move more into the practical policy sphere, where we're working with 17 public housing authorities in the Creating Moves to Opportunity project. And then we'll talk a little bit about our current pilot project in the Pacific Northwest, Seattle, King County, and Greg will talk about the broader set of projects that we are undertaking. So what is Moving to Opportunity? Moving to Opportunity is a randomized housing mobility experiment for low-income families who are living in the highest poverty public housing projects in the US in the mid-1990s in Boston, New York, Los Angeles, Chicago, and Baltimore. To be eligible, you needed to be living in public housing, you needed to have kids, and it had to be in a census tract with over a 40% poverty rate, or something like three, you know, times the national poverty rate. So in the sort of 3%, 4% poorest, you know, neighborhoods in the United States and in these metropolitan areas. And what Moving to Opportunity was to give families in these very high poverty areas an opportunity to jump the queue to get a housing voucher known as a Section 8 housing voucher, also known as housing choice vouchers, that makes your housing assistance more flexible, but also to give them help and certain group to move to lower poverty areas. So the study involved 4,600 families with about 11,000 kids, and it started in 1994. And how did this come about? Well, it came about in some sense for a very sad reason. It was motivated by the Rodney King Los Angeles riots of 1992. Which for a very brief moment led the US Congress to think a little bit about inner city issues and strategies to try to help people in some of the poorest neighborhoods. And luckily, one part of the 1992 housing bill had some demonstration money in it. And very luckily, the new incoming Clinton administration in 1993 actually allocated part of that to design a randomized control trial to look at, you know, two important questions, which are basically, we know from huge amounts of social science research and from observation that kids who grow up in better off neighborhoods go farther in school, they're healthier, they earn more later in life, as do their parents, but we worry a lot that that may not be due to the neighborhood itself, that may be due to the fact that it takes more money and parents have to be very different and your opportunity is very different to move to a better neighborhood. And what Moving to Opportunity tries to do is do two things. It's essentially randomizes access to these very rationed housing vouchers. In most of these cities, it was about an 8-year wait list to get a housing voucher. So it allowed you to jump the queue and expanded by 5,000, you know, by several thousand, the number of vouchers in these cities at that time. And the second is it's directly testing two interventions. One is the regular Section 8 program versus being in public housing. That's one of the treatment groups. And the other was an attempt to really help people in public housing when they get vouchers to move to low poverty areas defined as a census tract that had an under 10% poverty rate, so below the national average, a middle class area. And so we had restricted vouchers. You could only use them to move to low poverty areas, but we also had help from counselors, mobility counselors to help families move. And the first big question is, could you actually get families with Section 8 vouchers in very tight housing markets like New York and Boston in the mid-1990s to move to low poverty areas? And it was really tough. You only have, you know, typically 90 days to lease up, but we were successful in getting about 50% of the families to move, so there is a real experiment. And over the next, and this is, you know, Kate was talking about 2022 and stuff. Well, we've been tracking them for over 20 years. Over the next, 20 years, on average, the families, that got the opportunity to move through these low poverty vouchers lived in areas with about 18 percentage point lower poverty rates on average than the families in the control group. So it really did change their neighborhood environments. And on average, almost nobody in the control group ended up living in neighborhoods like the types that the experimental group went in. So the idea was to try to see, for the parents, is this going to improve their labor market outcomes, their health and well-being, and for the kids, would growing up in very different types of neighborhoods make a difference? And from the policy view, is using the same resources, effectively of vouchers, to get people to different neighborhoods a beneficial sort of policy, rather than the way they typically work, where over 80% of the 5 million families that have housing vouchers in the U.S. basically live in higher poverty areas. So what did a typical moving to opportunity move look like? So this is one of our sites, New York City, a map. The typical control, the modal control group member was still living, 10 years out in a public housing project, such as in Harlem, the Martin Luther King Towers. The typical Section 8 family was able to move some distance from that area. Typical place would be in the South Bronx, like Soundview. So they're moving from areas with sort of 50% poverty rates to 25, 30%, but these are still very high poverty areas, but much safer areas than where they started. And the typical experimental family is moving to an area like Wakefield, closer to Westchester County, which had sort of a 9% poverty rate in 1990, but the truth is, even though we said they had to move to areas with under 10% poverty rates as of 1990, most of them are in areas where the actual poverty rate by the time they move, say in 1996, is like 15%, because that's where you could actually use a housing voucher. A much better area, but somewhat declining area, you should think of is the typical place people move to. And you can see similar things. It was much easier to move in Los Angeles for much higher distance. The housing market really tough in New York and in Boston. In Chicago, it shouldn't have been as tough in terms of the housing market, but there's a lot of discrimination, and there was a fairly dysfunctional public housing authority, so the take-up rate was lower. But in most places, about half of the families were able to move in the restricted experimental voucher, and about two-thirds in the regular Section 8 voucher. So what did we find? This is, we have been tracking them for a long time. And since, I've been working on this for 24 years, I guess, if it's January 2017, starting in a basement of the HUD building in 1993 in a meeting with Henry Cisneros, then the Secretary of HUD, and a bunch of policy people from different departments. I was the chief economist at the Labor Department in the Clinton administration. I remember the planning meetings, and then later, as an academic, winning some contracts to evaluate this with Jeff Liebman, who was a student in our department of mine at the time, and Jeff Kling, and many years later with Nathan Hendren, my junior colleague, and my former student Raj Chetty, who's now at Stanford. So we've been tracking them for a long time with surveys and with administrative data, and the one thing I could say is it's gotten a lot easier. When we started this, there were no, things like measuring health with biomarkers, you couldn't get permission to do it, they weren't very accurate. We had, to get permission from every single state, none of them had, consolidated administrative data, separate applications to the UI employment thing, the Medicaid records, the AFDC records, every plus surveys. So this was many, many millions of dollars of collecting data in the early stages, and later in the last round we did, we basically linked it to tax data and spent maybe $100,000 for much more accurate stuff than cost $10 million in the earlier round. So the availability of more both at the federal level and at states integrating has made this much, much easier in 2017 than when we started out in 1994, where this was just an unbelievable undertaking to track, you know, 5,000 families who were moving around, you know, do surveys, and to even the administrative data, because, you know, some places would give us micro data, some would give us aggregate data, and it's really improved, although there's still a lot of state differences. So what did we find? For adults, I call this moving to tranquility rather than moving to opportunity. It didn't change the economic outcomes for adults much. But it did change their health and well-being. We find very consistent evidence 1 year out, 5 years out, and 15 years out of improvements in mental health and in physical well-being, both in surveys and in direct, you know, physical measures through blood spots on things like measuring diabetes. So if you can take some of the $650 billion in Medicaid programs and use them for social programs that improve health, this one actually has a proven record for improving health. If I guess if you can do nurse family partnership, we do have data here, substantial improvements in adult health. But we found very little on economic opportunity. And for the kids, we didn't see much over the first 10 years while they were young. But as we saw them in adulthood and were able to track them with administrative records, for the kids who moved at younger ages, we see remarkable impacts. 30% higher earnings when we see them at 25 if they were in the experimental group, about half as big in the Section 8 groups. So it looks very proportional to how much it changed your neighborhood environment, much more likely to go to college, much less likely to be a single parent, much more likely the next generation of kids are living in better neighborhoods. So this gives you some sense. The typical control kid in their early 20s was earning about $11,000 versus $15,000 for the experimental, and somewhere in the middle of the Section 8, about 22% are going to college versus 16%. And we're seeing substantial reductions in the poverty of the neighborhoods they're living in, and substantial reductions in the fraction who are single parents. So the next generation is showing improvement. And the hypothesis that really seems to show up here for the nature of neighborhood effects is what we call childhood exposure effects. The more years you have in a better neighborhood, the larger the impact. So if you look at the age of the kids, there is some disruption effect, particularly of moving as a teenager. So the point estimate's slightly negative, but not significant if you move, say, at 18. But each year you spend in a better neighborhood improves the outcomes, and the kids sort of moving below age 8 see very, very large outcomes. And so what we're finding in this experimental data is where housing vouchers seem to be really valuable for long-run outcomes is making sure families get them when their kids are young. And one of the huge problems of the existing system is, you know, even if you apply when your kid's really young, if it's a 7-year waiting list or 10-year waiting list, you're not going to end up with really young kids being as exposed as they should. So, as I noted, there's lots of other emerging evidence that seems quite consistent with this, from the demolishment of public housing projects in Chicago, recent work of Eric Chin, and my colleagues Raj Chetty and Nathan Hendren using the tax data to look at 5 million kids moving. We find that clearly childhood development effects are greatly affected by neighborhood environments. So what do we think this means? We think it means that we currently spend $40 billion of federal money plus additional state and local on low-income housing support. Most of it goes to housing people in public housing or in vouchers that don't get used in what seem to be the best neighborhoods that seem feasible for their kids, particularly for young families. And this is motivated an attempt. Are there ways within the existing budget, not just expanding it, to use that $40 billion more effectively to help families with children move to better neighborhoods? And that's really what we've been engaged with Greg and the broader Creating Moves to Opportunity group.
So from the practitioner side of this, the updated information on MTO comes out, And I have to give you a little bit of background on what happens to practitioners who have both public housing and vouchers in their portfolio if you own both of those. And that is that you believe ideologically in your hard units because they're right there in your city, and in some markets they're the only units you can get. So the notion that you're going to be fostering moves that might A, deplete those units, or B, move your constituency to other locations is a huge tension that housing authorities and some other state providers who have vouchers have to face. But once we saw the results of the study, and once we made contact with the research team, we began to think about how would it be possible for housing authorities who administer these vouchers to begin to focus on mobility strategies that made sense. And there's a number of layered issues when we think about actually encouraging a family through the voucher program to move, not the least of which is how the program is administered, which generally speaking is incredibly complicated, difficult, and when you have a voucher that leaves one housing authority and it ports out to another, that process, as you might expect, as any handoff in any kind of government system, is really weak. So we've engaged with the research team in thinking through a number of things that we've got on this slide. And how can we best support families in moving to new neighborhoods, including what business process changes could be made that would help those families along. And we spent some time when we got together talking among the 17 agencies and the researchers about, we didn't sound like that actually, but we're pretty close. But what kind of nudges could you give a family inside the current business practices, for example, and then what do you do in terms of getting them into the new neighborhood, and what other things should be in place to complement that move. Now, Larry's point about where the vouchers are now and that they're in neighborhoods that tend to shade and in some cases are in not so hot in terms of their poverty indexes is very important. So should we add these things? And the other thing is, what about the cost? What's the right balance between these moves and how would we pay for that? I would actually add a couple of other thoughts here, and one of them is, and this is, we talked about this, but we concluded it was just too hard to try in this go-round, was what are the potentials for lifting in place if you delivered the same set of services to an intact public housing site versus moving someone to a lower poverty neighborhood? That would be an interesting experiment, but it would be very difficult. So we created Moves to Opportunity. We met twice and have had numerous phone calls, and we have the 17 public housing authorities, and really we had 15 at the start and two more signed up. We have the goals listed here to use this research to understand the obstacles and to propose new ideas to help families move to high opportunity areas, and then develop plans for the evaluation and the randomized control. Our goal is to come up with a series of market innovations built around housing authorities that want to participate. We have, as you'll hear, a group of agencies in the Northwest. We have markets as diverse as Atlanta, Houston, Chicago, Cambridge, so that would be a rich environment, I think, for testing different evaluations and testing them in different markets. Given the size of some of the agencies, there's tremendous potential for the random assignment. And this, I find, the next bullet, and a lot of the other panels mentioned this, is that you have the researchers. We're engaging with them at the start and thinking about what the innovation should be and how to test it at the beginning. Speaking from past mistakes, We're perfectly capable of creating innovations, which we've done in Cambridge. Cambridge is what's called a moving to work agency. We have a deregulation agreement already in place with the federal government, so we can do numbers of innovations and that kind of thing. But of course, we can think up these ideas. Hey, what if we did that? And we do it, and then somebody says, well, you didn't evaluate it, so what is that really worth to you? So we really looked at trying to get this collaboration off the ground and designing projects in a number of market areas that would really pay dividends over the long term in terms of the research.
Team approach. So, yeah. So as Greg noted, we you know, it's a partnership with 17 public housing authorities, and you know, they span a wide range of markets. Some, such as the Pacific Northwest, is a very tight housing market that's, you know, where rents are going up into outer space, and you know, there are large barriers to even a very determined, you know, low-income family with vouchers to getting a landlord to pay attention to them. So we are trying to think about what are the right strategies in very tight, you know, housing markets versus ones that may be weaker, ones that, you know, have different, you know, potentials and histories of discrimination. And we're also thinking about, you know, certain tools that probably are useful anywhere. Just making sure you have better information about possible housing listings, some nudges and information changes, which you know, Peter Bergman and our team has been working on at Columbia will be universal. But I want to talk about a little briefly is our first project, which is starting in Seattle and King County, a very tight housing market. And we've worked, you know, with the two housing authorities and their policy directors from the beginning, and this is really a group effort. It's not we as researchers said we know the answers, let's come in and evaluate it, and this is, you know, setting up some new sets of interventions. One thing we think, you know, a real difficulty in a tight housing market is getting a landlord, figuring out what, you know, this is where units go very quickly. How do you in real time figure out what things are available, what are reasonable places to move in opportunity neighborhoods? First thing that we are doing is we're putting together much better maps of the neighborhoods to look at which places, based on the work of Raj Chetty and Nathan Hendren, have the highest upward mobility outcomes for the kids, and updating that, and then trying to help people find housing in that area. One part of this is trying to use rental brokers who have a lot more experience in the market with helping them, you know, get the time of day from landlords and deal with potential discrimination issues and know where there are reasonable housing openings in real time. The second part is directly trying to incentivize landlords with sort of guaranteeing security deposits and some of those short run type of issues that make it very tough to compete, such as the delays and inspections that often happen if you're using a Section 8 voucher, trying to streamline that. And the third is trying to provide short-run money to make these moves, you know, whether it's transportation, moving costs, and others. And we're working very closely with the public housing authorities, with MDRC and J-PAL North America in collaboration, and we have an interesting, I think, strategy where we have these three ideas and we're thinking about bundling them all together and looking at them separately, but sort of in the first year where we're starting in the field, you know, trying to, since these don't exist now, trying to develop and do more qualitative and data-driven research on what things are families actually using, what's the right package to think of when we, you know, sort of get to a little more maturity, and then let's do the, you know, full random assignment and track people afterwards. So in year one, we're sort of going to be developing things and looking at short-run outcomes. And then year two, the focus of outcomes will be what fraction of families do we get to move to better neighborhoods and do they persist? And maybe 20 years from now, if I'm still doing this, what the long-run outcomes of the kids are. Since one of the things we learned from moving to opportunity is short-run outcomes like test scores are not a very good indicator of housing in neighborhoods' long-run impacts. And Greg will tell you about the broader set of collaborations going forward to conclude.
So the different PHAs that are participating are interested in different strategies because the markets are very different, and what we try in the Northwest is not likely to look what might be tried in Houston or somewhere else. And we have had a sense of this experience so far. Our goal is to launch a couple more of these, we would hope this year. And here's where we are in terms of the partnership, and here's where we are in terms of some of the thinking. I'd say on the left side, one of the most difficult things for the housing authority is how long am I committed to, because these are long-term studies, very difficult, and the upfront investment costs. Some of the other things we're beginning to see is making sure that we have enough families and we would have enough for the sample sizes that would be required. And that bullet, 1, 2, 3, down there where it says business software. So housing authorities have antiquated business software systems, as you might imagine, like most of government, and they're not designed to do research. If someone had a gift to give, let's have a software package that could actually do research in institutions that are delivering social policy. So that would be on my Christmas wish list or whatever, because the software is bad. We are also looking at regional approaches. And there's a number of reasons why. We have them listed here. I mentioned the porting. I mentioned that housing mobility is a regional issue. If you live in this area, you know moving from Boston to Worcester is not a simple thing. If it's Minneapolis, it's Minneapolis, St. Paul, and the surrounding areas. These are all challenges to making a regional demonstration actually work, or a mobility demonstration working. But we have some opportunities here. I mentioned the Moving to Work program, which actually got mentioned today in Ben Carson's nomination hearing. There are 39 agencies expanding to 100. There's new legislation in place to encourage regional initiatives. And also, in the House at least, Paul Ryan's plan, A Better Way, mentions mobility enhancement. So this might be the time to seize the moment and begin to test several regional concepts. We also feel that we need a deeper collaboration with city governments. And sometimes the cities and neighborhood issues blend right into the mobility stuff that we're trying to work on. And the other areas that are listed would be a harder lift. Influencing the schools to provide support, probably in the receiving opportunity area, and cooperation on zoning opportunities in areas to secure more units for the move. One of the big barriers moving from an urban to suburban is that the housing stock changes very dramatically, obviously, and it becomes harder to do. There are other ideas floating around in the mix that maybe we could test someday, but this has really been a great opportunity. And if you've been a practitioner for a long time, this is really an awakening. It's like an epiphany. And I think there's the potential here to really affect social policy, and if we're patient, to come up with some programs that really serve these families in a better way. Thank you.